Hello viewers, hope you're ready for another exciting video about Red Hat Advanced Cluster Security. And in this case, we're talking about Advanced Cluster Security's ability to enforce security rules using cloud native controls. ACS is very much about allowing security teams to understand risk, decide what's acceptable and not acceptable, and set rules to enforce that. Any security tool has to provide enforcement in order to be effective at achieving security goals. It should go without saying that such an enforcement should be complete, should eliminate attacks or prevent conditions that would result in a vulnerability being exposed. But the way that we do it is important. And this video is intended to show how enforcement in an OpenShift cluster can be done using methods and approaches that are going to be familiar to the DevOps team to avoid disrupting applications. The types of enforcement that are supported depend on the phase of violation occurring. So when we detect a condition that matches a security policy, we call that a violation. Given violation can depend on the type of object that it's in, the scope of the policies, and of course it depends on the lifecycle phase. Here you'll see a number of deploy time phases. We also have runtime and we also have build time. The policies are structured in a similar way, and you'll see that some policies are written in a way that they apply to certain life cycles, but not others. These depend on the kinds of criteria that they're measuring. Something like the first two here refer to the age or when the last event occurred. So when the image was created or when the image was last scanned, and those are things that we can determine at deploy time. The 90-day image age is also something we can get statically from the metadata in an image itself. So there's a build time component. Some policies are more or less repeated. Here with the Alpine Package Manager policy, I have both a build and deploy runtime lifecycle, and a runtime lifecycle. We have two of those because we're detecting different things, different criteria. The presence of the package manager and image, again, this can be done in a static way versus a dynamic use at runtime of the actual process of the Alpine Package Manager APK being started within the process. Now, the runtime and deploy time actions are going to be different here, and they're not going to be enabled in ACS until I go in and modify the default configuration. In a lot of demos, you'll see the results of reports in initial installation. In your environment, you may see just data that's being read from the environment. When you want to get to the next step and understand how ACS can actually intervene in the process, you need to go in and make some modifications. So let's get started. Let's take a common policy, like the one default policy for dealing with vulnerabilities. This policy says to match when I have at least one vulnerability that is fixable, meaning that upstream is published an update to the package that fixes the vulnerability, and its severity rating is at least important. This means important and critical. These are the kind of vulnerabilities you care about. They cause the potential for remote access, arbitrary code execution. These are really the serious ones. When I look at my policy here, we're going to leave all the defaults here. If I want to make more extensive changes, what I should do is clone this rather than modify the default one. But let's go with this here. And we're going to change the policy behavior. Actually, in this case, we already have the build time enforcement turned on. This is actually a default, and we're going to take a look here at what build time enforcement means in the next section of this video. Deploy time, we'll come back and we'll look at a different policy here, but we'll look at the deploy time enforcement as well. And then finally, we'll look at runtime enforcement because they all look and feel a little bit different when the enforcement is actually occurring. Here we are. Let's take a look at build time enforcement from the perspective of a developer or DevOps person who is investigating an issue and wants to get security results for a given image or deployment. In this case, we're going to be using the roxctl command line. This is part of the ACS product. You can download it from the UI. You can pull it from mirror.openshift.com. It's a binary. It runs on multiple architectures. You just select the appropriate one for your environment. And you'll see there's a number of commands here. This is not a full examination of the command line tool, but know that this is useful for administration as well as for security checks like I'm about to run. Now I'm using an API token here to authenticate roxctl to central. It's important to understand that roxctl is not actually doing any of the scanning that you're about to see. In other words, it's not responsible for locally breaking down these images into layers and components and matching those to vulnerabilities. ACS does that running in my OpenShift cluster. And so I've got to point roxctl at that that central installation, give it the API token that allows it to authenticate there. And then it's really simple. I'm going to use what's called a roxctl image check. I'm going to point to my central deployment. I'm going to give it an image name that I want to examine. And depending on whether or not this image has been seen before, or if it has to go and retrieve it, this is a public image, so it just simply goes and retrieves it from quay.io. But it'll take a few seconds to come back with the result. And you can see it's broken down here. By default, this human readable output is going to tell me that I have, you know, recent Spring for Shell remote code execution vulnerability in it. And I have that policy violation that we looked at earlier, the fixable severity at least important. This is what we mean ultimately by a build failure, that there is some attribute here that means the build shouldn't continue. And we communicate that. You can see here in my shell that the output here is a non-zero exit code, right? This is going to be important because when I integrate roxctl into a CI/CD pipeline, it's this exit code that gets honored by those tools to determine whether the step failed or not. As an example of a CI/CD integration where the roxctl exit code, determined ultimately by the policy enforcement, can be used is here in a Tecton pipeline. I've got several pipeline runs here, some that succeeded and some that failed. And it's the same exact thing as we saw in the command line that I ran manually. The same kind of output, the same kind of indication of where the build failed, and ultimately the same exit code that tells the CI/CD pipeline stage that this particular one failed. So build enforcement really means nothing more than returning an error code in the API that roxctl consumes or any other API consumes. I ask the central deployment, does this image or does this deployment violate any of my policies? And if it does, then return this non-zero exit code. That's build enforcement. I'm back here in the ACS dashboard looking at my policies again. You may have seen the problem with build enforcement. You may have said, I don't care what that exit code is. I'm going to deploy my application anyway. You may have realized that it's not something that we actually can call fully enforced if we can't prevent the user from ignoring the result and pushing forward and going and creating that object, deployment or pod from that image in the first place. That's where we're going to come in and talk about deployment time policy. So in order to protect the cluster directly, we need to make sure that as much as we can, we prevent the unacceptable risks from appearing in the cluster. I would love, ideally, I would love to have everyone scanning their images early on, reviewing those policy checks to make sure that that image meets the requirements for vulnerabilities and configuration, but we just can't expect that's always going to be the case. So in the case of like a really serious vulnerability, right, or other misconfiguration, we have to back up that build time enforcement and information with a deployment time enforcement as well. So again, I'm going to edit a default policy. Best practice here would actually be to clone this policy, scope it correctly. We'll save that for another video. But I'm going to use the log4j remote code execution vulnerability policy as an example. I'm going to leave all the defaults here, and we're going to change that policy behavior. Here, we're going to add in both build and deploy time. So if I do have teams using the right thing, pushing those images through the build process, we're going to fail that build process at the time where they request a check for this, and hopefully they'll resolve it before they move on. If somebody does ignore that, the deploy time enforcement that I've enabled here is going to prevent the creation of the objects. Now, there are actually two different ways that the deployment here can be enforced. And what we're going to see first is the admission controller. We won't often see the backup, but there is a backup approach that allows ACS to scale down deployments to zero replicas if we don't use the admission controller. There's some discussion about using the admission controller if your customers are at all concerned. Be aware that there's a backup effectively where if the admission controller enforcement is not being used or cannot be used for some reason, we can still take action on that. So once this is saved, now I will jump back into the command line and show you what this looks like from the developer perspective. Now I'm back in my command line here, acting in the role of a developer or DevOps person, and I want to get my application deployed. I haven't checked it for policies, violations. I've ignored the results, whatever the reason is. Now I'm at the point where I simply want to create my log stash, in this case, deployment here. I've got that defined in a YAML. I'm going to create a namespace, and I'm going to create this deployment object. And what's happening here under the hood, of course, is that my command line is contacting the Kubernetes API, requesting these creations. And the create API verb is being monitored by ACS. The Kube API server allows us to plug in what's called a validating admission controller. And that's exactly what ACS has created. And in this case, you can see that the admission controller rejected the operation. So this failed because ACS took in the request. We looked at the YAML in this case. We examined all of the attributes, including the image field. And the image field we then looked into, used to look into the scanner data that we have to understand that this particular deployment has the log4j component that's impacted by the quite infamous at this point, 44228 from December of 2021. So in this case, the enforcement took the form of again, that same message, this clean and fast failure. And we think this is really, really important. Right? It didn't result in a mysterious log somewhere. If I go and look at my applications here and see what got created, if I'm troubleshooting this because I'm still confused about what happened, there's really no mistaking it, right? My object here did not get created. I didn't get what I needed. And I have the information here right in front of me as to what exactly happened. Again, if I'm not using a command line on a workstation here, if I'm using a deployment tool that automatically does this, that failure is going to propagate back to it. From the security perspective, this is good because we get a clean failure and it means that the offending risk is not running in my cluster. And even if the build process and the normal pipeline for evaluating images gets ignored, I'm still protecting my running clusters from these unacceptable risks. All right, I'm back in the ACS dashboard again to talk about runtime policies. And we can actually look at the lifecycle stage and see some of the pre-built runtime policies. And we can actually just pick one of these here to look for enforcement. Runtime means after the creation of the containers in the pods, in the deployment. So it's anything that happens after we've already passed our security checks for deployment. It means that vulnerability scans passed. It means my configuration scans passed. None of the risks rose to the level of unacceptable. But we need to keep monitoring those pods for activity that might indicate that there's an attacker in their mid-store. You know, maybe somebody in my team that's accessing something that they shouldn't be. You'll see that we have a couple different kinds of runtime events. Some are triggered by Kubernetes API calls, like executing into a pod. In fact, in the demonstration here, we're going to see this one as a precursor to the follow-on activity. Then we can look at activity inside of the process tables within the containers themselves. So because we're instrumenting the Linux kernel, we're able to see all of the process activity and associate it with pods and deployments and enforce those rules at that point. Now, there's lots to choose from here by default. You can create your own. We have visibility into any process names, arguments, user ID, even process ancestry, so we can determine if, say, a shell is spawned by a Java interpreter because that pattern matches common attacks. There's even just a generic unauthorized activity. These unauthorized policies look for anything that is not explicitly allowed by a locked process baseline. More on that in another video, but this is an effective way to monitor containers that should honestly be very boring in their activity that suddenly changes. Non-boring means a potential threat. And so these policies are ideal for identifying that. But let's take something simple. Let's take something like Linux add user execution, here. When we think about containers, we think about them sometimes as little virtual machines with file systems and user accounts and package managers. But really, they're not. They're not intended to be general purpose virtual machines. And certainly the adding of a user after the container started, remember, this is not defined in the image. This runtime activity is detected after the container starts. We don't want to see user accounts being added. So again, this is a great candidate for us to test out enforcement on. Again, I'm going to edit the policy. Again, I'm going to tell you that you shouldn't do this. You should clone policies that you intend to modify from the default. But we're going to change the policy behavior here to include enforcement. You'll see my build and deploy are blanked out. Again, this is intentional. These are not conditions that we're detecting about user accounts in statically defined in the image or the deployment. There are different criteria for those kinds of things, like running as non-privileged user accounts. What we're looking at here is specifically somebody executing one of the well-known commands to add a user account to a container. This is part of some attacks out there where a user, an attacker has landed a foothold and wants to establish a more permanent base in your environment in order to get further or to come back in later, creating that backdoor. So once we turn on this enforcement, you'll see how we can help to eliminate that. All we have to do is detect one link in the chain of events that occur during an attack in order to be effective. Now, if you're going to play with this, I'd urge you to create a narrow scope for this. That runtime behavior like this might actually be going on in your environment. We don't know what reason it is for. I mean, folks haven't gotten used to the idea of adding their user accounts elsewhere. We want to minimize the impact if you're just testing this. So do be careful with the scope, please. And then once we save this, we're going to have this active. And then we're going to jump in and we're going to look at what would happen if somebody were to execute one of these things, that these processes that matches the activity here. All right, we're back here in my command line. Again, taking that role of a developer, DevOps person. Maybe I'm troubleshooting something, and I'm actually going to go out and find a victim here a pod to go out and troubleshoot. And I'm going to look at this MasterCard processor in my payments namespace. So I'm just going to run an exec command. I could do this with the OpenShift console. I can do this, in other ways. It's a great way for me to be able to get in, log in remotely, access everything that's going on in the environment in order to troubleshoot a problem. It's also, unfortunately, a good way for an attacker to get in, or for a motivated insider who's determined to, steal data or make themselves a backdoor for later exploit. So it's something that needs to be controlled. But we're going to focus on the activity that occurs inside of the pod once I spawn that shell. So here I am, and I can do things like cat etc password, and I'm just running commands in here, and ACS is tracking all of this. I can do things like run attempt to run a package manager and install things. In this case, I don't have the permissions to do that. It's a good security precaution of itself. But lastly, I'm going to try to add a user account here. And this was the criteria that we created a policy for, use the default policy for in order to enforce. And you can see what happened here is that the whole session died. Okay. And this is, again, is very important. It's a little bit subtle down here. But the add user process was not terminated. The entire pod was terminated. And if I go back and actually take a look, you're going to see that the pod unique ID has changed from DTRJM to SJGXH. That means that the pod was killed and restarted. And I can actually see that in the Kubernetes events log. So if I take a look at why my pod terminated, if I'm a developer, I got an understanding here that something happened. My whole session was killed, and I've got a record of what exactly the reason for that was. So if I know enough about how to troubleshoot operations here, I can actually get an idea of what happened and get to the bottom of what the problem was and understand that I violated a security policy rule. We don't try to terminate individual processes. This is not a Kubernetes native way of doing it. A Kubernetes orchestrator does not understand what a process is. It knows what pods are, and it knows that when a pod is missing, it should be replaced per the replica count rules for that particular pod. So this allows us to do enforcement in a lightweight way. It's a complete removal of the attacker. So if that add user was just one of the things that the attacker did, and some of those signals were things that we didn't have a policy for, that we didn't know about, this completely wipes out that attack and starts the pod up from a clean copy. And if this is a running production environment, this is less disruptive to my application because this is really no different than a container exiting in any other way. It restarts, the application scales back up or scales back down depending on those rules. And so we have our continued operation despite the security event that occurred here.